Well, stock up on the noisemakers, silly hats, and Xanax. The 2020 election is only 838 days away. A new poll shows that 3 out of 4 Democrats believe it's time for a fresh face. Can you blame them? Check out their ghosts of candidates past. Biden, Hillary, Bernie, a cross between the Three Stooges and Cocoon. The only way to get out that vote is to deliver walkers door to door while yelling fire. Biden, he thinks Amtrak is a success. It loses $1 billion a year. Hillary, everyone loves a rematch, but everyone also loves a winner. The only thing she's won is ridicule. It's less a rematch and more a remake of Bride of Chucky. And Bernie, a relic pushing another relic called socialism. He's likable, but his beliefs are toxic. He's like those delicious berries you pick that poison your whole tribe. And we can't forget Liz, can we? But as someone who is 2% Native American, I have reservations. I do. I could say that. I'm Native American. Part of me. Not sure what part, though. So Dems want somebody new, somebody different. Where could they have learned this?
Anthony Weiner. Did you know that? She's married to Anthony Weiner. You know, the little bing, 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 bum, bum. I love you very much.
Yeah, from the guy they hate so much. That's the hypocrisy. The people who despise Trump are now looking for their own Trump, meaning a punk rock outsider who rejects the establishment and wins. Why? Perhaps we figured out that the worst thing about politics are politicians. Mm-hmm. And if we learned anything from 2016, it's that nothing will ever be the same. Right. You can't go home again. And if you're a Democrat, that includes retirement homes. So, yep. They need a new face, especially one that knows the issues. My choice?
We need to occupy every airport. We need to occupy every border. We need to occupy every ICE office until those kids are back with their parents.
Capitalism has not always existed in the world, and it will not always exist in the world.
You use the term the occupation of Palestine. What did you mean by that?
I think what I meant is like the settlements. I am not the expert on geopolitics on this issue.
Trust me, Democrats, pick her. You will win in a landslide.
They might.
Dana, you agree with me?
Well, I think that when the Democrats, every election is about new, but this is why we had hope and change.
Yes.
Right? And the Democrats did go with something new in 2008. They rejected Hillary Clinton and they nominated Barack Obama to be their candidate, and he was able to win. And then the Republicans go the other way. They're like, okay, well, we're going to go with Trump. So now the Democrats are going to have probably 15 to 17 people on stage fighting it out. Over the next, I mean, it's not far away. The midterm election is November 6th. The 2020 general election starts November 7th.
Mm. Right.
So you really are going to start seeing a lot more of this. And I don't think that necessarily she would win this time around, but the left is becoming more progressive. They want somebody new and different, somebody who's willing to fight, even if it's futile, right? For example, on the Supreme Court nomination of Dan Pfeiffer, who was the former communications director for Obama, he's out on his book tour now, and he says, even though we know we're probably going to lose, it's worth fighting.
Yeah.
Fighting to the death. Like, well, you might just fight to the death.
Yeah, it's like when you're arguing with a spouse.
Right, just stop.
Yeah, you won. Welcome back. You did a great job at the All-Star game. I think I have to defend Alexandria. Most people don't know how to explain the Middle East.
No. And especially if you're 28 and she's a newcomer to the political stage, and forget the geopolitical stage. She's never been on it.
Yeah.
I don't think she's gotten there yet. Mm. But I think you're exactly right that people want a new face. And it's not only that they want a new face. It's interesting. I saw in the polls that there's a split between people who voted for Hillary as to whether or not they would even take a Hillary back. Now, I think where the argument you'd get, Greg, is from the Bernie supporters.
Right.
Who see him as, Cortez, same thing, more energy. And here's one thing I noticed in the research. Democratic strategists saying, we want somebody who will punch Trump in the face, mm-hmm. right? So they want someone who plays like Trump, who's bullying, has the kind of
rhetoric. De Niro.
It could be De Niro, right? Yeah, that could be. But I think an actor, a celebrity, right? Somebody who brings name ID to the table, has pockets of their own money, mm-hmm. and challenges the party's base. That's sounds like your guy's candidate.
Yes, yeah, there you go. Yeah. All right, Jesse, I like the idea of a rematch. The reason why, I don't think Hillary wants to be forever known as the person who lost to Trump. That's going to be the first line in the obituary. Not that she was Secretary of State, but that she lost to Trump.
Twice?
What?
But if she lost again, that she lost twice.
That would be a great
idea. It hurts worse than the first time.
That's right.
I don't think that's a good idea.
I have listened to a lot of kind of mediocre and preposterous monologues, but I think that might have been one of your best monologues in a long time. That was very good. Almost as if I wrote it myself. Just kidding. No, I think the Democrats need to nominate a fresh face, and I'm going to be contributing to the campaign coffers of this little socialist Cortez, whatever her name is. But the Democrats are right. When they pull this, they want a fresh face. They win with fresh faces. They win with Bill Clinton. They will with Barack Obama. And they lose with Gore and Kerry and Hillary. So, like you said, they want someone that's going to punch Trump square in the face. And they don't want to do this Michelle Obama thing where, you know, Trump goes low, we go high. They're ready to get in the mud, but there's problems with that. The only person I can see really going toe-to-toe with him verbally is Biden. And I would not call Biden a fresh face. Also, when you get in the mud with Donald Trump, you never really get out. He's a brawler, and he wins ugly.
Look what he did to Rubio.
Exactly. That was ugly. Yeah. And also, it doesn't set up a contrast, a mini-Trump. And I think you win when you set up a nice contrast, but they're having a civil war. Mm-hmm. And the energy and the idealism is on the far left, and the money and the practicality is more towards the center. And we're going to watch this thing, and it's going to be great to watch, but the media is going to cover up all this internal friction, and that's going to be to the detriment of the Democratic Party. It's better to have all these fights out in the open.
Well, it's interesting, too, because to Dana's point, Democrats used to be really good at sort of stifling primaries and clearing them out. And now they're not as much because you have this progressive wing of the party that is super charged up. We've seen that come in fruition. This primary primary time where we hadn't really seen that before. But I think the bigger problem for Democrats is President Obama had really focused on identity politics for 8 years. And with that, you saw a narrowing of the Democratic Party. And Republicans were able to take advantage of that during the midterm elections. And President Trump was as well, of being able to pick up these Democrat strongholds that hadn't gone for Republicans in quite some time. So I think this push to the left, focusing on things like abolishing ICE, only further narrows the party, which hurts them and is a negative impact heading into 2020.
Well, you know, that's the point. It actually, Juan, is like, and I mean, we talked about this, about how Trump wasn't an ideologue. He was some of these stances he had were liberal. Some of them were definitely not Republican. What if should the Dems be focusing on somebody who is not an ideological Democrat?
I don't know how we would define an ideological Democrat on the left. I mean, I'm not sure.
A communist.
I think that's the way you guys are
Democrat, socialist.
Don't ask a Republican to help you. A Republican will not help you.
I was foolish. I was a foolish man to ask that question. You know what I think, though, is interesting? I think the counter to Trump may be a woman.
Who do you want to see?
And a young woman, not unlike that
Rosie
one.
O'Donnell.
No. Like, I think a young, energetic woman who is unapologetic in saying, you know what? Yep, I think we should have health care in this country. Yep, I think that we should raise the minimum wage. Yeah, I think that we should have no more student debt for people who are trying to get an education.
Who is this lady,
That's
though?
Pretty strong. Well, she's one of them, but I think she's too inexperienced.
How old is she? Don't you have to be 35?
Yeah. 28, right?
Yeah. You got
to run for president, yes.
Right. Yeah. That eliminates me, too. You know, this contrast thing, large number of Republican candidates that looked alike made Trump stand out. We've talked about that. So I think you're going to end up with a Democrat that stands out.
Right, because a lot of the 15 possible Democrats, a lot of them are senators.
Right.
Okay, and it's hard to run from the Senate. Obama did it, but I think McCain and Hillary Clinton showed that it's just
Kerry.
Really hard. Kerry as well. I have a surprise that his name hasn't surfaced a little bit more. He has a book coming out September 24th.
Ooh.
So you might want to add
Dana's
John Kerry to
you planted the seed with Al Franken. And look what happened with that.
Yeah. Who else do you want me to add?
The
other
cross
thing
off
is,
the list.
Though, that what's interesting is President Trump will have a record to run on. And he will be a known entity to Republicans. He's got right now a 90% approval rating amongst Republicans. So he's running solo, and he has a record to run on and a good economy. Then you have this massive primary where really only 20% of the country is saying, okay, we are really far left. 20% are saying they're really far right. Now you see in surveys, 60% of Americans are saying, I'm independent. Mm. So what happens if in the primary you go so far left? To me, that gives President Trump a pretty good opening to walk right back in.
And also,
and here's where I just think the Democrats faced their hardest challenge. When the Tea Party was ignited, it was based off of policy. It was based off of bailouts and Obamacare and spending. And they had these great rallies where they cleaned up after themselves.
Yes, they
did. They had speakers. And then they translated that into winning back the House. And they did all right in the Senate. They kind of cut their nose off despite their face a few times. But it translated into electoral success. The Democrats' energy, I wouldn't call it at the level of a Tea Party. I mean, right now they have small rallies. There's no great speaker. And their basic message is, I hate Trump. It's not really around a policy. And the policy that it is around is either abolish ICE or we want socialism. Well, and their tactics have backfired, chasing people out of restaurants, yelling horrible things at people. I just don't know if they're ready for prime time in terms of fielding good candidates to take back the House.
Well, and it's also when you have a crowded primary field, you can see a lot of these people that are being discussed, like a Kamala Harris, a Cory Booker, they all kind of occupy the same space. You could inevitably see someone come down the middle like Trump did, President Trump did, that nobody saw coming.
Struck.
Yeah. But I think the one thing that's not in the equation as you've drawn it is the tremendous energy on the left because of Trump. And I think that now extends to the middle. And you see that in the polls, Jesse. The intensity on the left going into the midterms far exceeds what you're seeing on the right, even with something like Kavanaugh, and certainly when it comes to taxes. I don't know what the Republican message is other than we don't like immigrants.
Jobs, economy,
that's a
winning.
Cheap shot.
Oh, you know, the truth can be cheap.
I said it's 838 days away. It's actually about, 20, where are we now? 2019 is where it's going to start.
It's kind of scary that it's so soon.
No, it starts 2018.
You know what? It starts right now.
Yes.